come before you in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, I thank you for this time, Abba. Thank you for this time you've given me and the opportunity to talk, Abba. Father God, I pray that your presence be here, and that I pray that you, those who are listening, be blessed by this words I'm going to speak today. I thank you, Lord. I praise you. I worship you. Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. Today, I chose this on love of Christ. I've been thinking about this topic for quite some time, and I was thinking I wanted to talk about this based on the scripture verses that's given to us this year for Lent season. Philippians 3:13-14. Brother, I do not count myself to have comprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. As I meditated on the verses, all I could think was, what a mighty plan our God has for us. What an awesome God we serve. What an amazing love he has for us. This is indeed agape love. I doubt if I can do full justice on talking about his love for us, but I'm going to try. How much he loves us. How big and awesome heart he has. The creator of heaven and earth should come down to this world to dwell among us and give us the ultimate gift of salvation. It's like a multimillionaire coming down from the palatial house to spend some time with a friend who dwells in the slums. But this king is full of love. What a royal and a mighty king we serve. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. I come from a Hindu background, and I know what efforts people take to attain moksha or salvation. But see, our Lord Jesus Christ has done everything and has given it in a silver platter. All we have to do is accept it and walk in his given commandments. How simple is that? Romans 5:8 says, but God demonstrates his love, his own love toward us, in that when we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Just imagine that. While we were still sinners, our Lord Jesus Christ died on the cross. Who has ever done this for mankind ever before? While we were still sinners, we were sinning, he took our punishment and died the most excruciating death on the cross. Here we see our Lord's love for us. There can be no greater demonstration than this. When we love, we can forgive others who sin against us. The kingdom of God is for those who love and forgive others. He set a mighty example for us. It's not easy to forgive anyone who hurt us. But because our God has set us such an example, that with the help of Holy Spirit, we are able to forgive and love those who curse us. In Hebrews 13:1, it says, let brotherly love continue. When our focus is on Christ, it becomes easier to show brotherly love to each other continuously. Luke 6:32, it says, but if you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners love those who love them. It's no big deal to love those who love us, but to love those who curse us is what God expects us to do. Our Lord emphasizes this point again and again, to love and keep His commandments. John 14:15, it says, "If you love me, keep my commandments." Now, why is it important to keep His commandments? Because when we keep His commandments, we are close to Him. We can hear His voice clearly, just like loving parents want to talk to their children. He too wants to speak to us through His Word, the Holy Bible. He communicates with us and keeps us in the right track. He wants to fellowship with us, share, and He cares for us. He's like a possessive mother who loves her child to death. Our Lord, He guides us, helps us when we are in need, consoles us when we grieve or in pain. He cheers us when we are morose, just like our earthly parents do. We can rely on Him more than our earthly parents. Therefore, there is no love compared to our Heavenly Father's love. So aptly it's written in the book of Isaiah 49:15, "Can a woman forget her nursing child and not have compassion on the son of her womb? Surely they may forget, yet I will not forget you." Wow! What comforting words these are from our Heavenly Father. Jeremiah 31:3 says, "Lord, the Lord has appeared of old to me, saying, 'Yes, I have loved you with an everlasting. Therefore, with loving kindness, I have drawn you.'" Oh my, everlasting love? You mean forever? Wow, that means we are going to be with Him forever and enjoy His love, fellowship, and walk with Him in His kingdom. I'm enthralled, excited, and look forward to that day. John 15:10 says, "If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in His love." Yes, in this verse, He's inviting us to keep the commandments and abide in His love, so we too can be like our Lord Jesus Christ, Yeshua, Messiah. All the verses from the Holy Bible on love are taken, and many more are there, is to say that how big and mighty is the plan of our God who loves us. Because of His love, He made salvation easy as A, B, and C. A is for accept His free gift of salvation. B is for believe in His death, burial, and resurrection. And C is for confess your sins and you are saved. Once we are saved, we can look forward to a blessed hope to be the bride of Christ Jesus, our Lord. We are not any more citizens of this world, but we are citizens of heaven and are waiting for our groom, Lord Jesus, to take us there. Moreover, we are removed from the face of this earth before the wrath of God is poured out on this earth. There is no condemnation for those who believe in Him, who bore our sins upon Himself and died. It's so pleasing to read Paul say in 1 Thessalonians 5:11, "Therefore, comfort each other and edify one another, just as you also are doing." Yes, all brothers and sisters who are abiding in Christ's love, who are living on the blessed hope that is of our Lord's second coming, we ought to be encouraging. sustain each other and comfort one another, which means we read our Bible, discuss the Word of God, teach each other, pray for each other, love one another, and pay attention to each other's needs, and work in harmony to get ready to meet our Maker. Just like if we were to meet with any high dignitaries who's of greater status in the society, like a governor or a president, we would prepare. We would work diligently and be talking about it many, many days before the D-Day arrives. Likewise, we need to do the same in much diligent way to meet the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. There is nothing more exciting, more happy moment than to look for that blessed hope for us believers in Christ. We live in the last seconds of our time here on earth. Therefore, we must do, as Paul says in Philippians 3:13 and 14, brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Yes, let us all, like Brother Paul in Christ, look upward call of God in Christ Jesus by doing what is written in the Holy Bible. Let us pray. Dear God, we come before you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and thank you for the precious gift of salvation. You have accomplished everything for us on the cross, Lord. We accept the gift of salvation, Abba, and pray and request you to grant us more of your Holy Spirit to keep your commandments and do your will and love one another and abide in your love, Lord. Lord, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Please, Lord, give us the strength to keep all your commandments and be ready for your coming. We praise you